started. After several months, I spoke to John at the convention in October in San Francisco, and we discussed coming to Boston to talk for the AES. He showed interest in that, so I pursued it. And I'm really happy that he can come and work that out with us scheduling-wise and hear what he has to say about his presentation. So, John Stewart.
Thank you. Pleasure to see everybody. Thanks. Pleasure to be here. Honor to be here. Teach at Berkeley in the spring, so it worked out nice with the schedule. This is a, well, it's exactly that. It's a little bit of a perspective on audio recording environments, recording studios. This is about the third time I've done this talk. I keep refining it a little bit. It started in Switzerland about a year ago. This is not a lecture on acoustics and how to. I just didn't want to do that. We could do that, but that's not what I wanted to do tonight. So this is a little bit more fun. I design recording studios 40 years, so about 40, celebrating my 40th year doing it. We have a company, Walters Thoric Design Group. Walters is not my middle name. It's Beth Walters, my wife, right there, who's with me in a rare appearance at one of my talks. And we're partners in everything. And we have about 40 people in four offices around the world, so just two in South America, Europe, New York, that more or less just do technology spaces, studios, auditoriums, home theaters, and whatnot. I guess the headline shouldn't really be that, but the headline is that although everybody thinks recording studios are over and that they're not happening and that we're out of business, it's about as far from the truth as possible. It's just simply not true. And I hope to share some of that with you. There are some things that have changed, and we should be aware of it, okay? But it is just simply not true. As a matter of fact, there are more studios being built than ever before for some obvious reasons when you just take two steps to the right and start to look at it. So luckily for us, we have more work than we can handle. We're busy. It's exciting. I'm 63. I guess I don't have to do any more work, but it's fun. It's actually very exciting, and there's a lot of new cool stuff right having arrived in the last 5 years and just on the horizon that is actually making it even more exciting. So I think this kind of a little chat is an interesting time to have it. Okay, so we'll see how this goes. I hope it's not too long. I'll try to move along. Okay. So couldn't have a better place to put this slide up. As I said, normally I'm not doing this in Boston, so I don't even have to discuss this slide. Obviously, everybody knows that we're ground zero for the beginning of everything. For me, things start with this guy. Things started in Greece, and we can discuss that for a whole other 5 hours. But this is the guy that really, in my opinion, you know, woke up and said, you know, there is a relationship between all these walls and surfaces and boundaries, and created some algorithms, of which one of them still sticks today, as we all know. So it's pretty exciting. The most interesting thing here is the date, 1900. It's not that far. It's pretty close. It's actually not that long ago. Okay. So, and this is another obvious slide. The studio world, and that's what we're talking about for the most part, recording studios, okay, is linked to audio technology. Okay, the two of them are pretty linked. No advances in technology, not too much reason to have recording studios. In fact, one can make the argument there's no reason to have a recording studio unless you're recording. Okay, and recording by definition is just that. It means capturing something and putting it down in some kind of medium. So the two are completely linked. And I guess with the age of digital, the two really have now become very, very linked and very, very married and very, very glued. Okay, and that, even that, is arguably only 50 or 60 years old. A few slides just to remind us exactly how far we've come in not that much time. Okay, and these are fun to look at. Check out this date, 1953. Now we're only talking about 50 years ago. Okay, so it's a relatively recent thing. So let's zero in on studios. This, you know, the curtain opens up with this. Okay. In my humble opinion. I mean, there were studios before 1950. But basically, let's try to flash back to 50s and early 60s. Studios are are environments for engineers, okay? And musicians are the unpaid talent on the other side of the glass that we try to get in and out of the engineering environment as quickly as possible. It's sort of kind of a necessary evil. You know, if we could just make the records without the musicians, it would be easier. It's that kind of a thing. And these spaces look like that. They look like spaces for engineers. They're small. They're not supposed to be good looking. They mainly are there to house equipment, the audio recording equipment. Story is actually a bunch of widgets that people are putting together. It's not like you can buy a studio in one box. Interestingly enough, the video recording industry has a whole different approach, okay? And you actually can buy a video studio more or less in a box called the switcher with one or two other devices. But for some reason, not the audio world, and I'm not quite sure why that happened. Probably has to do with how audio engineers arrived at this place. And so this is a room where lots of little widgets from different aspects of the industry are assembled, and it looks and feels and sounds more or less like you'd expect. Unbelievably enough, okay, and now it starts to get interesting in the early and mid-60s, amazing music nevertheless gets pushed out of these rooms, okay, and we find that pretty fantastic, but still not too much attention to the rooms, okay, and even with the Beatles, you know, they were in and out, and it is true, they make these records in a day or 2 days, at least in the beginning of their careers, because these environments are for engineers. They're controlled by engineers. The distribution of the music, okay, is controlled by a very small number of people. We'll talk about that in a minute. Everything about it, okay, is not particularly artist-friendly, okay? Again, look at some of the dates and some more images of studios. This is the world that I arrive in. I'm 63. I started, as you'll see, in 1969, 68, and it's kind of fortunate to be starting at that era. Okay, somebody had to be there then. I guess not me. I guess that's the way I look at it. And this is what I think studios are. The first studios I walk in look like this. Okay. And this is the slide that I think is one of the more interesting ones. The artist finally takes control. So why did this happen and how did it happen? It happens in some loosely in a very small amount of time from the early 60s to the late 60s. And it's not like one artist took control, but a bunch of artists took control of how the music is made. Buddy Holly, arguably maybe one of the first, okay, to basically say, I'm producing myself, take it or leave it. And they had to take it because he was just too powerful. Guys like Brian Wilson, Jimi Hendrix, et cetera, because of, you know, the amount of success that they had and the amount of vision that they had, basically take control of producing the music, and simultaneously some of them take control of producing and engineering the music. And it wasn't a very big stretch, okay, for those people to then take control and or demand that the environments are not what they're pushed into, but hey, these can be my environments. Either I want to own them or I want them to look a certain way. And so it's no surprise that in the middle and late 60s you have the dawn of the great era of recording studios lasting about 20 or 30 years. Independent recording studios by the hundreds, artist-owned studios that either are built for themselves or for commercial purposes or a combination thereof. The artist takes control, so everything's different. Okay, and of course, once that happened, then the entire way that music is produced and distributed and the business of it changes. We'll talk about that in a minute. Everybody kind of knows where that's all heading, including the demise of the record companies as we know it. Okay, but we're focusing on the studios. Okay, so this is one example of one of those studios. The reason why I'm flashing it is because I have all the slides, I have all the pictures, and it's my first studio. A little career lesson, if you have to start with something famous. Okay, that's about the only conclusion I can make. And it's a little bit of a break that this was how I started. I had no idea that this was exceptional. This was just what happened to a very fortunate 22-year-old. Okay, but the story of this studio, which is interesting, is in fact the story of about 20 studios, all happening more or less at about the same time. We have some slides because it's about 40 years old now. And it is the oldest working studio in New York City, still surviving, actually doing very well. It's gone through some ups and downs, okay? And it is true that a lot of well-known studios in New York have closed, but this one hasn't. Actually, this one's expanded. Just signed a big new lease pretty well-known engineer, Michael Brower, just moved into one of the rooms, and they're doing really well, whereas other studios have closed. The model has changed. The business model has changed for studios. We'll talk about that, okay? But about 4 or 5 years ago, they had this 35th anniversary, and they celebrated it, and they asked a bunch of people to talk about it, and they almost demanded that I talk about it because I had a lot of old pictures of construction and drawings and whatnot, and they thought that would be interesting. And I hadn't been there for 25 years. I'd not walked in the studio for 25 years. So we dug all this stuff up. That was the event itself. You can recognize Al Cooper and Bob Margoloff and Eddie Kramer, who really co-built it along with me. The history is pretty interesting. The studio is in the basement of this building, which was built in 1928. A little serendipity striking here. The building itself was built by that young architect, Frederick Kiesler, who I'm sure nobody's heard of. He only built really two buildings. Okay, but ironically, as an architecture student, which is what I am, I'm an architecture student and a musician and a very amateur baseball player. But as an architecture student at Princeton in the mid-60s, he was one of my favorite architects, and I only knew him from two buildings. I did not even know about this building, but I did know that building, that theater that he designed, which was in fact the theater in this building, and up until about 15 years ago, existed more or less like that. The screen changed above Electric Lady Studios. I had no idea that 3 years later I'd actually be working in the basement of this guy's building. I didn't know where it was. I never saw an address. I just knew that he had done it. But the basement was a speakeasy club for years and became a blues club in the mid-60s. Jimmy went there and, as fate had it, decided to... these are some buildings that Frederick Kiesler designed, and that's the building that I did really know, which is the Dead Sea Scrolls Museum. And I fell in love with this building when I saw it in picture form, and then finally, later on in my life, got to actually go there. And the other person I was in love with was Antonio Gaudí on the left. This was a building on the right that Kiesler designed, which luckily didn't get built because it's pretty frightening. But nevertheless, I was very influenced by these two architects. I just fell in love with them and thought they were extraordinary. Serendipity strikes when, a whole other story that's irrelevant, okay, at a school I got to design a tiny little club in Soho that actually got famous on the cover of Life magazine, okay, and Jimmy went there, decided to build the club in this basement underneath the Frederick Kiesler movie theater, went to the club that I designed in Soho, and basically had his manager call me to design his club. And this is the only drawing I have of the club in the basement that now became Electric Lady Studios and had a lot of curves and ramps and shapes and whatnot that he really liked. And that's, we worked very hard. And at the last minute, the club was trashed by his engineer, Eddie Kramer, who I wanted to strangle, who had no interest in a club but wanted to have his own studio, having just come over from England. Eddie's become a lifetime friend and a big, is up in Boston a lot, as you know. But at that moment in time, I was a little angry at him for destroying my potential club. But the studio, nevertheless, we stayed on in the project. I had never been in a studio, quit my day job, tried to learn as much as I could about acoustics, and somehow in a year and a half built Electric Lady Studios, which more or less looks like this still today. The control rooms changed many times, but the basic Studio A is still there, and even some of this is still there. It's all in the basement. There is no Electric Lady on the ground floor. You just enter through a little room and go downstairs. And these are some of the original drawings, and you can see some of the curves. Here's the up and down drawings, the sections. Even though these curves got into the studio, they were really leftover ideas from the club that Jimmy wanted. Even the ceiling is kind of like this propeller-shaped ceiling, and we tried to, some principles still very valid today, some not, but it was quite an experiment to do it. But the main thrust and the main idea of the studio was that it was artist-friendly. That was what was not in existence in most studios. Changing lighting. I mean, in a sense, the whole room was supposed to be almost a theater. The control room was very big. Most control rooms were very small. This was going to be really, really big. A lot of room for people to hang out on. The idea of a lounge in the recording studio was absurd. Now the lounges are bigger than the control rooms. I mean, we have studios where the lounges, the artists talk more about the lounges than the control room. These were all sort of new ideas. This was the original entrance, subsequently torn down, unfortunately, and even that had to have a curve and whatnot. And you can see how it was influenced a little bit by, at the same time, I was doing one other little project. parents. But here are some construction shots. And even though over 40 years, almost 40 years old, is an excellent site for a studio. It was on the bottom, it was on slab on grade, very few columns, very tall ceilings. Building was a concrete building, solid concrete building, excellent isolation, even though there was a theater on top of it, you could hardly hear it at all. Okay, and it was a good site, and still is a good site for a studio. We were able to build all the walls out of double masonry, a technique that you would still use today if you can. Okay, it's sand-filled masonry. It doesn't really get too much better. Yes, there are new advances in isolation materials, limp mass vinyl, enhanced G-rock, commonly called quiet rock, springs, RC1 channels. I mean, we have a lot of cool new stuff that's come out in the last 40 years, but nothing like sand-filled block, okay, if you want to get some isolation. Nothing like mass and air. It still really hasn't changed at all. And that's exactly what we did in this studio. The isolation engineer was a kind of radio station acoustician by the name of Bob Hansen, who I actually went and worked for free, just to learn how to do these details. It was something that really changed my life. Essentially, I was an intern, an unpaid intern, for about 3 to 6 months. And these walls are all still there. Nothing's really changed, actually. So here's some construction shots going up. Notice the air conditioning duct, which is still there 40 years later, oversized, low air velocities. These principles really haven't changed that much. 1 year later, over 1 year later, the studio is finally finished. Not too many shots of the studio then, but we had a few. Even though the shot's funky, you can kind of get an idea where Jimmy was coming from. And he did have some input. He hated straight lines. I mean, he just hated things that weren't soft and curvy. I mean, exactly what you'd expect. But he really could express that. So the ceiling propeller shape, nothing parallel to the ceiling, to the floor, was very successful. In fact, it was so successful that later on in the history of the studio, the carpet came out and the whole thing was floor. It was turned into wood because there was no flutter echo at all between the ceiling and the wood floor. And all this, of course, this is all easy to do now with modern, with current theatrical style lighting, but then it was a little harder to do, but he wanted it to sort of feel and be like a theater, okay, and that was the goal. So some early shots. I like the black and white shots better because your imagination can kind of get a run for it. And unfortunately, this is a good shot. It shows that curve that originally started from the, it's still there, that existed from the club design, and we brought it over into the studio. Of course, the associated murals from the 60s and whatnot. Actually, a friend of his painted it, and that mural has moved, is now in the studio. They moved it into the studio. Some shots from the early days. This is interesting. We finally got to the bottom of this. The reason why there's three is not 5.1 or any of that kind of stuff. It's basically stuff was still issued in mono. Stereo was a big deal, so they had to issue stuff in mono and stuff in stereo. So three speakers, that's really the reason for it. And, Lena Horn shot, and some interesting shots of 40 years ago, Jimmy Page and Robert Plant. But you can get it was very comfortable to hang out at the studio. There's only a few shots untold of Jimmy in the studio. He died too young. Of course, we're all saddened by that, and this is one of them. He looks pretty, very content in the studio. So, and almost 40 years later, or actually now 40 years later, studio is still there. The control room's been revised a few times, much more contemporary speakers, and it actually pushed out. Console got bigger, et cetera, et cetera. But the studio is still the same as the Boston guy who's worked there. You all know who Rick of Cassick is. And there's that mural that moved, and it's the same. I mean, 5 years ago when I walked in, it was extraordinary. I could say so many things were still exactly the same. They just had been painted. It was amazing. And doing well. So this and other efforts in California, this is the age of some really well-known independent studios, Record Plant, a little bit later on, Hit Factory, Brian Wilson Studio, Neil Young Studio, artists are having studios, some famous studios in Nashville are all bubbling up. Not that long ago, less than 50 years ago, maybe 40 years ago. And it's all because the artist is taking control. Either the artist is owning their own studio or they're demanding that they're treated to a studio that that caters to their needs. And so we enter the age of great studio design. So, of course, when that happens, two other things happen. We have a tremendous influx of great gear, which everybody knows a lot about, and it's easy to follow that. Okay, and multi-track went from 4 to 8, et cetera. So everybody knows that history. Still haven't gotten to digital yet. Okay. And at the same time, another history is happening, which is not so common and not so well documented, which is what happens to acoustic materials or the whole science of acoustics. Okay? And that also developed and exploded. And that's the one, of course, that's a little more interesting for me, and that's what we're going to discuss about. So, you know, I remember the first time I ever saw a two-channel FFT analyzer, which doesn't make the headlines. It's not making the front page of the New York Times. But it's pretty amazing when you can see on a screen a real representation of what you're hearing. And because the minute that happens, the whole business of analyzing rooms and talking about rooms becomes instantly more democratic. That's the word I'm going to use a few more times. I'm trying to, okay? And the minute that kind of discussion and conversation becomes more democratic, things are going to get better very quickly. Because a few people can't control the information. And they also can't create voodoo or even wrong information, for that matter. Same thing was happening in the business of music, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, I mean, when enough kids stole the music, everybody realized we don't have a business anymore. And that's, in fact, exactly what happened. And then it forced people to figure out how to create a new business model. And that's really what's happened with studios. There's plenty of studios. You're not hearing any less content. Anybody hear less noise? The world is noisier. All this music, every time you hear something, it has to happen in a studio of some sort. It's just that the business model changed. And it imploded on itself. People got greedy. People thought you could build anything and they will come. That's true for a while, but not true forever. And in fact, that's exactly what happened. That's a business conversation. Maybe in another building in the business school, people can have that. I'm more interested in what did we learn? Because, you know, when somebody wants to drop $1 million on a studio, you can experiment with 50,000 of it. Okay, and so, for instance, the entire development of diffusion, okay, albeit championed for the large part by companies like RPG, but other people, okay, I think comes about because studio owners are ready to test it and push it, okay, and, you know, they're ready to either blindly believe in manufacturers or maybe test some esoteric papers that they read, et cetera, until finally everybody really gets comfortable with it. Artists start pushing it, the designers start figuring out how to maybe make it look a little bit better, how to really get it to work, manufacturers finally figure out how to get it cheap, and all of a sudden something like a Skyline diffuser, which is basically an amazingly efficient two-dimensional diffuser that you can Velcro on your ceiling, arrives. That didn't just arrive off the board in the first few months. It took about 10 years before that kind of product was called for and developed. Again, not making the headlines of the New York Times, but interesting, I think, in this kind of discussion, because that's what we're here talking about. That I find interesting. Because that kind of product is why 10,000 people can have small studios today. 10,000 people can't have this and don't even want this. Okay? But a few people still want this, and they're still interesting because we can learn from them, can push the window. But 10,000 people are interested in $5,000 acoustic packages. That's interesting. That is interesting. I assure you, that's what's happening. Okay, and we want to be a part of that. We are a part of that, whether we want it or not. In fact, if you don't want to be a part of it, you're just not going to be in the acoustic design industry. That's okay. You can go to another industry. Okay, me, I'm happy to be a part of it. I have no problem with small studios. As we will see, small studios are exciting, but they do have some very interesting problems. Okay, which we'll talk about. Anyway. So it's a wonderful story, it makes us all smile, okay, but it's not really the future, these big studios. So we have this era of big studios, okay, and again, this slide reminding me of what I just told you. Things have become more democratic. By that I mean anybody can have a studio, okay. It wasn't that long ago that anybody couldn't have a studio. They were just too expensive. They were too expensive, too complicated to build, controlled by a very few people. Everybody now can have a recording studio, okay? You may not be able to have a recording studio that can record 20 people while it's raining and use wide open U57s, okay, that you may not be able to have for $10,000. But you can have a recording studio, you just have to change the rules a little bit. Whereas it used to be that not everybody could have one. They were just too complicated, okay? So it has become more democratic. Let's take a quick look at the music industry, because it's, for me, the recording studios are about the music. No music, no studios. Music could mean what you were listening to when you were walking in. And actually, it's Outkast. I didn't know it was Outkast. I know you're interested in the Celtics, but he's pretty good, Outkast. I like him. I like that music. So, but it's about the music. Okay, so no music, no recording studios. There's really no reason to do it. Let's take a quick look at it. I'm borrowing these slides from Chris Stone, or some of them. I distilled his talk from last year's AES. Some of you might have been there. It was a pretty good talk, okay, and I got permission, and Chris and I talked about these later on, and I'm not going to repeat them word for word. You can read them as they pop up, but this is how the music industry used to work, okay, and when I say used to work, it really doesn't work like this anymore, you know. A few major labels controlling artists, you know, artists made albums, and then they counted on the label for support, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and that was one diagram, and it had its roots. It basically has its roots from the film industry, which sort of still is a little bit like that, although that's beginning to change. Okay, and then of course those people essentially controlled the retail side of it, sometimes legally, sometimes illegally. But so that's one model. This is over. This is really over. I mean, there are no more music stores and records sold. Coffee, you know, Starbucks sells more music than Virgin megastores. I don't even know if they exist anymore. So this is a little bit more about how it works today. And notice that if you just want to not read too much, we can just go to the red. The artist owns his own recording studio. If he doesn't own a recording studio, he's pretty damn close to owning one. Okay, because they're so cheap to rent them, and they're everywhere. They're not just in the big centers anymore, that they're a commodity. Once something becomes a commodity, then the reason why one is better than the next is not because of voodoo or some kind of distilled marketing algorithm. It's because taste, okay? And I think it's because of the art. One studio can become better than another one or more interesting because it really is genuinely more interesting, not because somebody says it's interesting, okay? Not necessarily they sound better, they sound different. Or they feel different, or they make me feel more comfortable, or they have the exact relationship and equipment that really exactly parallels how I want to record. I'm not being told how to record, okay? So that's when I say the artist has his own recording studio, and literally a lot of artists do, okay? I'm pretty sure, and I'm not sure if I even have the right to predict the future, but I've been asked to make some predictions. I'm pretty certain that every artist will have his own studio. It's just like everybody has their own car. I mean, there was an era when everybody didn't have their own car. Just a few rich people had cars. Is there anybody in the world today, at least in the United States, that feels they shouldn't have their own car or couldn't have their own car? No, if someone doesn't have a car, it's just a momentary hiccup. And they're either in their financial condition or they live in a city and they just don't want one. But, you know, having your own car is like having a hamburger. It's a commodity. It's not that complicated anymore. But it wasn't always like that. Okay? So very, very different model now. Here are some interesting facts. The interesting one is the download one, I think. Okay? You know, the huge increase in downloads, huge increase in iPods. This is obvious stuff, but the numbers are staggering, okay? And yes, a lot of the downloads are stolen, but that model's changing, and it's changing pretty quickly, okay? All they had to do was just make it cheap enough and easy enough to get, and then enough people are not going to steal it. I mean, people were stealing CDs, too. I mean, let's not think that was panaceic. And it's the real reason why the record companies were making a lot of money is because they were basically not sharing it with the artists. And then they basically forced us to buy everything four times. That's what happened. I had to buy those Beatles records four goddamn times. Okay, and I might have to buy it a fifth time, I guess, if they, what, remastered version's coming out tonight, I guess I'm going to have to buy it a fifth. They could do it again. And I probably will, I guess. I don't know, maybe. We'll see. But that's the real reason. But, you know, the downloads are incredible. Okay. more information about the music industry. And again, rise of digital musical sales. That's a no-brainer. It will continue to happen. It's easy and it's completely consistent with the artist taking control, distributing their own music, and the recording studio. Recording studios are heading towards all digital environments. We're not going to get into a debate about analog and digital. It's an amazing debate. And it's one that we could have at another time. And we're doing a lot of studios with analog equipment. We'll see some of them, and there's a reason for it, but you know, digital is just too, it's like debating whether things are going to sooner or later be completely green. It's a stupid argument. Of course they are. Okay? You know, but it doesn't mean we're not going to use wood. And it probably doesn't even mean we're not going to use tar. And actually, you still can use asbestos in certain situations. Okay? Also, what does green mean? So, but, you know, digital music is definitely here to stay. More trends and more opportunities. Niche marketing, that's the one that I like, because niche studio creation. Okay? Every third church in the United States has a recording studio. Every 10th radio station is a recording studio. Every school has a recording studio. Even schools that don't teach recording have recording studios. Okay? You couldn't rattle these kinds of numbers off 10 years ago. They all got to be built. They all have to be designed in some manner of speaking. They all have to be manned. So people who are teaching here in the student world, trying to figure out where students are going to go, they all need people. They don't run by themselves. Okay? They all have to be repaired. Okay? And since the equipment is basically a commodity, it means it gets tossed every 3 years and replaced. So everybody here's got a role in that kind of information. That's what's really happening. Okay? Doesn't make for pretty headlines, but it is really, in fact, happening. At least I believe it is. So there's a lot of new opportunities for music entrepreneurs, okay, and studio environments, okay? I mean, like, I don't know if it's on here, but the one that I always thought was interesting, and it's still true, at least it was true last year, that the gaming industry completely overshadowed the film industry in gross sales. It's bigger. It's simply a bigger industry. There's more gross sales in gaming than film. So what does that tell you? Okay? And games have tremendous audio opportunities. I mean, look at every game. Every game has 10 times the audio that the length of the game because they have all those options. And we'll actually see a studio we did for Electronic Arts. So production opportunities growing. Okay, and despite a few very well-publicized large studios closing, and you know, nothing like bad news to make the news. This thing in Mexico, I'm not really sure if it's an epidemic. I don't know. Epidemic is a very, very strong word, but it makes for great news. Everybody really does want to see bad news. Nobody really wants to see good news. Okay, so yes, a few large studios did close. Okay, the real headline would have been much more interesting for us. The real headline is that the business model of studios being built and run like limousines, which is essentially how they were run, that's over. Over. No need to do that anymore. There still will be a need for some limousine studios, okay? But building hundreds and hundreds of thousands of them, okay, is over. There's really no reason to do it, okay? Studio time costs the same now as it did 20 years ago. You do the math. Obviously, that's not a particularly good business, okay? Why? Because nobody needs them. Supply and demand, basic low-level economic 101 thinking. That's the real headline. Sony Studios and Hit Factory, arguably the two most famous studios that just closed in the last 2 years in New York, they closed full. I don't know if anybody knows that. They were full. They were busy. They didn't close because they weren't busy. They closed because of real estate opportunities that were presented to the owners for the land. It was just too rich, and they took the check. But not because there was no business. Actually, those two studios closing have actually allowed a few other studios to open. I can tell you because we've done them. And it's very interesting. So, Anyway, how's the audio food chain? What does this look like? How was it, and is it, and what will it be? Okay, so this one I like. How do we listen to music? We used to listen to it like that, and this is the one that scares the crap out of me. This is kind of how we listen to it now. So for me, this is a sad moment. It's a sad moment in that the quality hasn't gotten much better. It's probably a sad moment for most people in this room. I'm probably speaking to the choir in this room. Convenient? Yes. Amazing? Yes. You got your whole library in your pocket? Absolutely incredible. Absolutely extraordinary. But 40 years later, I've actually gone backwards on quality. So that's a struggle, and that saddens me. However, what's strange about it, though, is that the production levels haven't gone backwards. There's still a demand to produce music at very, very high levels, if not higher levels. Now, I'm not quite sure why, okay, because you run up at the argument, well, it's going to end up on an iPod, who cares, okay, but there still seems to be a desire and a need to produce music at very, very high levels, and actually the better produced music sounds better on iPods than the not so better produced music. Always has. It just always has. So I actually think that this will change. I think this will get solved, and I think the guys behind the digital technology will actually figure out how to get this stuff to either be lossless or, you know, other kinds of technologies. So I don't concern myself too much because I don't see any trends whatsoever to not produce music, thus, you know, make music, make content, create content in studios at very high levels. In fact, I see increased demand for people to for people requiring and demanding that the equipment is better and their environments are better. I see it at the mastering rooms. I see it in studios, and I see it from the equipment manufacturers, despite the fact that the final delivery product is pretty funky. So I'm not quite sure. I don't have a complete explanation for it. I don't have to have an explanation for it. But it is a little scary that everything ends up there. Maybe this is part of the reason, okay? Because in the middle of all those iPods is the home theater wave, okay? And the fact that basic audio in homes has gotten better and better and better. And also basic audio in cars has gotten really, really good. Car audio delivery is sensational. Even a crappy car, even a normal car, actually has really good audio, okay? And we're a car culture. And the world is a car culture. So while the iPod is huge and it's an amazing tool, the iPhone, these are great devices, extraordinary devices, and allows us all to carry our music, it's kind of like an undertow, like an undercurrent of this kind of environment, home theater, residential audio, automotive audio, which is actually just keep pushing the bar up. But for whatever reason, production still stays high and the demand for our environments is high. This is good. So how's music produced? Used to be produced there, okay? But let's take a look at studios, and that's what brings us really to the bulk of what I'll show you, which is just a whole bunch of studios that we've done. They're all studios that I've done because I got the pictures and I'm here and nobody else is, so I guess we're going to look at our studios. But there are other people that do this. There's about a dozen of us that are doing it at this kind of level, I would think. And we talk to each other sometimes, actually sometimes more than sometimes, and exchange notes and whatnot. And I believe everybody more or less feels the same. I've shared these thoughts with about three or four other people. Facilities aren't useful. I mean, if you want to record 80 musicians, you're going to have to do it unless you want to take your chances in an open field, which actually is uninteresting, even if the weather is good, you're going to need large rooms. Also, small groups still want to record in large rooms. And there's also a huge trend, thank goodness, to groups recording together. Remember, bands used to play together at the same time. It's an old idea. Coming back, very live, very cool. So there's still going to be a need for large production facilities, but large means expensive. And also, large means we don't need to own it all the time. So there's still always going to be large production facilities being built, and some of those will work in the old-style business model. And they are being built, and they'll be in the obvious places, you know, the music centers of the United States, which are growing. It used to be three cities, now it's 10 or 20 cities, and that's good. I mean, who would have ever thought of Atlanta as a center, as a music center in the United States? It is. It's a huge, it's a big music community. scene in Atlanta, huge scene in Austin. Okay, even Minneapolis has a little bit of a music scene, et cetera, et cetera. So always going to have these guys. The large studios are fun. They're certainly fun for me. They're certainly fun for people like ourselves. But they're also fun for us because we can experiment, okay, with materials. You get to fool around a little bit, push the window a little bit, and then stuff that you learn in those can trickle down into the smaller ones. Okay, so we'll take a look at a few. Ironically, the first one I'm putting up just closed. Okay, so having said that, it didn't close because it wasn't busy. Actually, it had plenty of business. This is a lair outside of Woodstock, and it's extremely large. Some people call these destination studios or vanity studios. This one was, in fact, a destination studio and was a little bit of a vanity studio built by an owner, but was built to run and rent like a limousine. It basically run by the week. You would rent it by the week. Artists would live there. It's huge, and we're looking at this. We'll use this. That guy right there is this right here. So this building is this building, and then there's a whole other building, and people are living there, and that's the reservoir from New York City, actually. It's on the top of a mountain outside of Woodstock. And we got to take this building and add a whole other very, very large control room right to the end. Originally, I thought the control room could be here, looking out over the Catskill Mountains and then look into this big room. It's this room that we were chasing, okay? But in the end, it was easier to just add a control room right onto the studio. Very, very large analog console, big full 5-1 monitoring system, et cetera, et cetera. It took over a year to build. And these are a lot of fun, these studios. Very expensive to build, but you get to play around with a lot of technology. It's not every day that somebody wants to put in a full frequency, very, very large 5-1 monitoring system. So that's a chance to play around with that. Ironically, larger control rooms are actually much easier to design than smaller control rooms. We'll talk about that a little bit. Okay, so in this era where rooms are getting smaller, there's a few problems with small rooms that we actually have to pay a lot of attention to. And they're classic mistakes. They're not mainly low frequency control. I might as well cut right to what the issue really is. Low frequency modal control. And everybody here who knows standing wave philosophy and whatnot knows, of course, as the room gets smaller, the fundamental eigentone gets higher. Okay, so if the room, at a certain point, if the room's big enough, there is no standing wave. You don't have a standing wave problem in the Celtics arena. There's no standing wave problem. There might be an RT60 problem. There might be an intelligibility problem. There might be 20,000 Bostonians making too much noise problem. There might be an air conditioning problem, but there's no standing wave problem. The room's just simply too big. By the time you get up to the 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th eigentone, you're just about coming into our frequency range, and so everything's squashed together. No modal problems. Just the opposite in a small 200-square-foot room. The very room that everybody's building now, okay? Put Pro Tools, put a few panels up. Of course, the panels only absorb at mid and high frequency. Put some near fields on the console. We won't even talk about the comb filter. And the room's boomy, and I have a comb filter at 400 or 600 hertz. And everybody, what happened? That's what happened. Okay, but it doesn't have to happen. It's just everybody thought it was really easier in small rooms. Actually not. Might be cheaper, but it's not easier. Anyway, we get to have some fun with these rooms. This is why the studio was built, because this space was extraordinary. It was 1920s. Lodge, actually. It was like a summer house. Very, very thin. There was no heating in it. And so the low frequency control was extraordinary in this room because it just went out. It just went out to the outside. That's what was absorbing the low frequency. It just went to the outside. So when we built the new building on the outside of it, we had to leave a lot of air between the new building and the old building, which we did with spacers in order to keep the low frequency still to go out of the very thin redwood siding, which is basically what was all the skin of this building. So we'll still have these vanity studios few and far between. That's the view from that room right over here. That's not Photoshop. That's actually really what you see. And It was a wonderful place. I say was because it just closed. There's a possibility it might reopen, but I think the owner has kind of lost interest in keeping it going. This one hasn't closed. This is the audio production facility for Electronic Arts, which is arguably one of the largest gaming facilities. So this is one of their two or three big giant production centers. This one's in Vancouver. And in the basement of this building, I think it's over in here, way down underground, is this 25,000-foot facility for video and audio production. This is the room we'll take a quick look at. And the gaming world is very pushy because this room had to be able to record almost any kind of music. Sometimes they're recording 15-piece small orchestra. Sometimes it's wrestling grunts. Sometimes it's rock and roll. Sometimes it's ADR. So it has to be able to go from very, very dead to very, very light. So this is a big studio, but this is absolutely not on the limousine model. This is what I would call purpose-built studio, essentially an in-house studio, and all the business is already there. We will see more of this. This is actually what's flooding the market now. People that have a reason to have their own studio. In the case of Electronic Arts, they have three studios, and they're booked all the time. One, two, three. So we'll take a look at what this is. And again, a lot of fun. Okay, big room, 5.1. Gaming industry has been 5.1 for years. Even before they were issuing anything in 5.1, they were tracking everything in 5.1. all digital console, etc. Screens, so they take their cue from the home theater industry. They have to be very sensitive to that. And we're seeing home theater and pro audio getting closer and closer, both visually and equipment-wise. And that's the studio. Some variable acoustics, we'll see a lot of that. Very common now, because studios have to be a lot of things for a lot of people. So sometimes the room has to get very dry, sometimes it has to get very reverberant. And studios can be fun. In this case, the studio looks and feels like that because it kind of ties into the rest of the building, which you only saw an aerial of, and the colors and whatnot were picked up from the color palette for the rest of the building. So again, the artist, or in this case, the client, takes control of the studio. They can have it look and feel and be anything they want. Okay. this was a large studio complex. Basically, we built brand new studios in Russia. So this is kind of the NPR of Russia. Broadcasting. It's kind of like the quasi-government broadcasting that does all the classical music. The Moscow Orchestra records in these giant rooms, which are extraordinary, but they've been around for about 40 years. So, again, you can see the kind of fun we can have. Now, notice these rooms are not that big, okay? Not that big at all. And that's a rendering of, well, this is the rendering, and that's how we finally got it to be built, okay? And my first question was, why not use Moscow? Why not use Russian engineers? A lot of smart people over there. They were not interested. They only wanted Western studio designers. They only interviewed Western studio designers. They just felt they were the most contemporary, and they were the ones that were pushing everything to the most. You're going to see a lot of this kind of stuff, a lot of ceilings that sort of seem to be floating down. This is a trick we use a lot because this is all fabric. And on top of that, is low-frequency control. Low-frequency control is the bane of most small to middle-sized rooms that are stiff. So that's a little bit of acoustics. There's about as much acoustics as we're going to do today. But controlling mid and high frequency shouldn't be that difficult if you kind of think about it. It's either going to control it with geometry and reflection control, well-placed diffusion, or scarcely placed or critically placed absorption, most of which is mid and high frequency. Now, that's a mouthful, and I said it all in 60 seconds, and I would be lying if I said that in 60 seconds you could master that, but conceptually, this shouldn't be that hard to do if you just practice it enough. Low frequency is totally different because it's not acting like a line. It's not acting like a ray. The wavelengths are too big, okay? It's like taking a big ball and dropping it in a small bathtub. There's no line. The line of the wavefront is very, very fuzzy, thus you get a splash. So, as the rooms get smaller, the relationship between the room and the wavelength, okay, gets nastier. Whereas if the room gets bigger, even big wavelengths still look like lines when they hit the surfaces 200, 300 feet away. Everybody either knows this, or I'm reminding you of it, or what the heck is he talking about? I better look it up. One of those three. But everybody here knows this, because this is AES Boston. This is, everybody's sharp here. So in mid and small rooms, the kind of rooms we're talking about, 400 feet and down, and the tendency is for small rooms, but still isolated. So what does isolated mean? Isolated generally means stiff boundaries. Now, you don't have to have stiff boundaries to get an isolated room. For instance, you could build your studio as a tent and just have it in Antarctica, and it would be isolated because there's no noise. But generally speaking, that's not the case. And so our rooms end up being stiff. Three layers of sheetrock, 8 inches of sand-filled block, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Even quiet rock, as magical as it seems to be, as the advertising says, is still real. As a matter of fact, it's super stiff. It's very heavy. Okay? So stiff boundaries means what? No low frequency passing through. Low frequency is not a problem in your living room when you put the sub in because the walls seem to absorb the low frequency and the modal tendencies seem to be squashed. Why? Because half the low frequency goes into the next room. Very good for the living room, not too good for the next room. I don't care about the next room. Studios, we don't have that. Studios usually require isolation because we don't want to bother our neighbors and we don't want to be bothered. So these small rooms, where's the low frequency? Where are we doing? Well, we used to suck it up with traps and corner things and whatnot, but that world changed in the last 5 or 10 years. So that's what I'm leading up to. And I kind of do it a little bit at the end, but I feel like doing it now because the pictures show us. The world of very, very thin membrane absorbers. This has exploded. This is incredible. Again, not New York Times front page material, but very important for us. Okay, so an RPG Modex, okay, or VPN plates from Europe that are actually imported by RPG because they realized they were really good. There's two, three other companies. By thin, I mean 8 inches and thinner. This is very exciting because now we can get pre-manufactured, okay, tested, tunable, low-frequency membrane absorbers that don't absorb high frequency. A big giant trap with baffles, which we used for years, also absorbs high frequency unless you cover it with a very thin plywood, but that's tricky because you have to know how to do it and it's expensive. So this is really good because now we can predict, along with the computer modeling, we can predict where the bumps are and we can squash the bumps and flatten out the modal response in the room. And that's what we usually do, and we usually do it in the Z dimension because the Z dimension height is usually the lowest, usually the most problematic. So it's no surprise that a lot of these rooms have these kind of suspended clouds that are transparent with these membrane plate absorbers or rubber membrane absorbers on top, and that's what you're seeing here. So we'll see this a lot. Okay. So yes, there are larger studios, and I could show you hours and hours of them, and we still have them from time to time. We're going to look at two at the very end. Tony said, we want to see some stuff you're doing now. I want to see some large stuff you're doing. So we put some on at the very, very end. But this is what's really happening. Okay, more and more studios, most likely smaller. This would be a large studio, in my opinion, and they get smaller from this. So this is for Timbaland. This is an artist-owned studio. Yes, there are artists. Most artists have their own studios, actually, and some of them require big studios. Usually the big ones mean loud. That's why they're big. Big usually means one or both of two things. They want it really loud. Why? Because cultural reasons, okay? Urban music guys want it loud, or they want to record, and/or they want to record on a large console. Again, that's a kind of a social decision. It's not a technical decision. You don't even need a console to record. And we have a lot of studios with no consoles. I mean, no control services. They just don't need it. But some people like to see all 48 faders or 64 faders. They just feel comfortable seeing them. And so, the minute you put a 10-foot object in a room with appropriate outboard gear and large monitors that are driving that size room, so now you're up to 400 or 500 square feet, you get these kinds of environments, and there are people that are always gonna wanna have that. So we have these, and here's another one. This is Jay-Z's studio. This is Rock the Mic in New York. They have two rooms like this. Notice that the studios, the live rooms are small. They don't need them to be big. Basically, 99% of the time, it's one person talking. Most of the music is made digitally, but the talking, the rapping, the singing, okay? So basically, glorified vocal booth. Notice that the lounge really is bigger than the studio. That's the lounge, that's the studio. No fooling around. I mean, that's a requirement that the lounge was that size. It's all about the artist. It's all about the culture of the recording. But there's nothing substandard about the studio. Extremely accurate, tremendous low frequency control, tremendous extension all the way down, almost down to Nyquist. It's incredible. Big subs down below the speakers. You'll see a lot of speakers at ear level. There's no argument against ear level monitoring, and there's an awful lot of arguments against non-ear level monitoring. But of course, if you want a big piece of glass to look out to a big live room, then you have to get them up, and how we do that and avoid comb filtering is really the art of mounting those speakers. But the easiest way to avoid all of those problems is to just simply not put them up there, and to put them at ear level. Okay, either smaller window or windows to the side. Windows to the side cause another kind of problem, but it's easy to compensate. So you'll see some of that. Green Day Studio. This is their personal studio. It's like a club, really. It's their work office. Okay, Goo Goo Dolls. This is their studio in Buffalo. That's a lot of rack equipment. He really does use all of it. I asked him. I said, do you use all this? He says, yep, I use all of it, and he loves it. He's a collector. Johnny Resnick is a collector of this stuff. He's an analog guy. It's just the way he likes to record. He has no problem with digital. He understands it. He just likes it. And it's a lot of, that's the most rack equipment I've actually ever installed in the studio. This was fun because this is the first time we got to do a studio over 20 years later. We had done this studio 20 years earlier. And they bought it. They were the studio rats in the studio in Buffalo, and then they bought the studio when they became well known. This is Alicia Keys' studio in Long Island. That's just the back of the building, tiny little building. This to me is more what I think is happening. This actually to me is spot on, and actually this room has gotten us a lot of jobs. I mean, it doesn't hurt that it's Alicia's, and it doesn't hurt that a lot of artists have gone through there. And then we've gotten some calls from them or calls from people who they've spoken to. But it represents to me, and I'll borrow a Buckminster Fuller term, the bare maximum. I wish it was my term, but it's not. It's Buckminster Fuller term. Got to study with him when I was really young. Don't need any more than this. Don't need any less than this. Okay? And this is coming from a person who could have anything she wanted. There's no money issues here. And she actually, Alicia likes technology. She's pretty handy at it, too. I mean, she has an amazing engineer, okay? But the control room is, it's the first room in New York to use an AWS. They've swapped them out for dualities now. I don't really care about that conversation. What's interesting is they chose a hybrid console, and I think that actually is very much of the future. This is a person that said, I like certain things about analog, but I love certain things about digital, about the workstation, about the AWs, in this case, Pro Tools. Okay, and the AWS, Duality, Genesis, et cetera, those kinds of boards and that kind of thinking, I think we're going to see more of. I know you're going to see more of. Well, you're going to see people taking small analog boards, matching them up with controllers, or people even making their own analog boards. Okay, I mean, now I'm seeing, we have two projects now where they're just essentially creating a console. They're buying 10 Neves and a few APIs, and they're using one of those monitor controllers. There's a few of them out there, and they're putting it in, and they're kind of making a console. We've gone full circle. It just, 40 years ago, you had to make a console. There were no consoles, electrically. You couldn't buy a console. You had to make it. You ordered it, and it was made, bit by bit. So here, 40 years later, they're kind of making the console. It's kind of bizarre. I just realized that last week when I heard this. Wait a second, you're building your own console. Yeah, because I want the best of the analog world and the best of the digital world. So I said we would discuss that. Artist takes control, and they can do it. It's not even that expensive. Okay, not that big. Doesn't have to be that big. Just big enough for her. Okay, relatively small, which happens to be a little bit of an accident. Kind of inherited this building. Not inherited, but this is the building that arrived in my life. They bought it. It seemed to work out well for them for some other reasons that we don't want to get into. So again, how do we deal with very, very large level, high levels at low frequency, okay, and still control it? The trick is in the ceiling, above the ceiling, are 4-inch thick membranes, and right in this wall, which just to the naked eye just looks like fabric, and it is fabric when you go up to it, but actually right behind the fabric is very thin plywood, okay, and behind the plywood is very, very dense insulation, so it's all membrane absorbers. There's very little broadband absorption. Very little sonics. I don't I'm not down on Sonics or RLX or any of those guys. It's all the same, as you, of course, all know. Or fiberglass, you know, Johns Manville, 704, you know. This stuff's all more or less the same. I'm not down on it. I'm just saying it's very limited, okay? And it also can get you in a lot of trouble. You can think that you've taken care of your environment and all you did was eliminate a flutter echo and it's still boomy as all hell and you made the room too dead and acoustic instruments are going crazy and drummers are confused, et cetera, et cetera, when it would have been better to actually apply what you need, where you need it, sparingly and exactly. And more and more people understand that and know how to do it. And the prediction tools got better. We'll take a look at some of the prediction tools. In the studio, we're just having some fun, okay? Mostly diffusion. This is all little pieces of flutter-free. That's an RPG product, those little mini diffusers, but we leave a little hole between them. So it's a Helmholtz resonator, and if you angle them, you get a little bit of, you know, you get, not only do you get some interesting architecture, but you also get parallelism between this plane and the hard surface, okay? And also, but more importantly, is the air changes behind it. So if the air changes behind it, the notch characteristic of the Helmholtz, I mean, Helmholtz is pretty narrow. But if you change the air behind it, in other words, instead of leaving 4 inches, you go from 2 inches to 10 inches, what happens? You flatten out the notch filter characteristic of the Helmholtz resonator, and it becomes a little bit of a low-frequency broadband absorber, exactly what I want. I want something that absorbs low-frequency, scatters, and reflects high-frequency. Constantly looking for that toy. Okay?
Yeah. What's the big difference between the acoustic you're trying to create and the live room? I mean, are similar kind of sized rooms.
Actually, the live room's a little bigger. Live room, control room, very interesting question. Okay. Control room has very demanding acoustics, both in the frequency and time domain, but in more or less one location. Very demanding, bad news. One location, good news. So what's demanding? Well, frequency response from 20 to 20, you know, plus and minus 5 dB narrowband, that's very hard. I'm not talking about making 1/3 meters flat. That's bullshit. Excuse the language. That's just wrong to even do that. Took a narrow band plus and minus 6, that's basically flat. And then in the time domain, okay, making sure that your initial time delay gap, for instance, is inside 15 milliseconds and greater than 10 dB. So that's another characteristic. And there's three or four more others. We've got a series of characteristics that we're trying to accomplish more or less in one position. Okay, and so when I hear, well, it's boomy in the corner, my reaction is, who cares? Anybody mixing in the corner? I don't care what it sounds like in the corner. I just care what it sounds like in the mixing position. Now, in the studio, it's different. There, we're probably more interested in statistical acoustical information, so general decay rate and the ratio between, say, 1K and 125. What's the difference between the RT60 or the RT10 at 1K versus 125? Because that will affect how a drum records, for instance, okay? Or how much isolation can I expect from one side to the other if I put gobos? That's another kind of characteristic that we are interested in. Or how quiet is it? Okay, so some rooms we really do want NC15, okay, because we need to open up certain microphones. So it's a different kind of set of requirements in a studio. And then there are a lot of non-acoustic requirements, sight lines, loading, other kinds of things. I find studios to be a lot easier to design. Also, depends on the music. Control rooms don't depend that much on the music with the exception of the amount of equipment and how loud they need to get. After that, the requirements are all quite similar, okay? Studios are very different. For instance, some studios really demand and require variable acoustics because the business model, or I shouldn't say the business model, the usage model is a wide variety of uses. Whereas other studios have only one use, like what would be an example? A vocal booth for advertising agency. I'm only doing one kind of recording, okay? Basically, who cares about 60 hertz? There's no 60 hertz in the room. I don't even care if there's 60. You can roll it out, it's not even on there. So those rooms need to be rather dead or rather dry. Or if you had four vocal booths, if you had four ISO booths, you could dedicate one to one kind of sound, one to another kind of sound. So different kinds of requirements, okay? I don't know if they look the same. They have the same color palette because the same person did it, and it's in the same room. Actually, Beth and Alicia together pull that off. And that's the personality. That's not for this lecture. That's not for this discussion. That's just what people, that's how people wanted it to look and feel. Actually, it's a pretty handsome room. This is also handsome, done by a different set of people, okay? Only in Italy could you have this, okay? This is very Italian, right? I love this room, okay? Notice no console. No console. No money problem. They have tons of money. This is one of the most successful studios in Milan. No console because they just simply don't need it. It's all DAW, and I asked them, how come no console? They said, well, it's faster without a console. You can work faster without a console. Basically, this is audio for advertising, mostly recording off of these vocal booths. Very cool studio because you can look through one to the other. And this room, the third room, right there, can share and use either one of these guys. And they're all isolated from each other with triple wall construction. Okay, and then this is a skylight. It's blacked out for the picture, the motorized shades, but this is a skylight that daylight comes in, and this is a piece of glass, which was kind of bizarre. They wanted to have daylight in their room for a lot of their work, so it turned out to not be that difficult, really, just figuring out the angle. So, you know, things that at first glance it doesn't seem like a studio, but it just meets the requirements of the particular user. Okay, the sky's the limit. To an extremely small studio. This is two studios. This one I like. This is two individual control rooms with a shared ADR booth with four Foley pits in it, no less. A corridor, a little machine rack, a bathroom, and a kitchen down here, no less. All in about 750 square feet, the same size as that first control room we looked at. This is small. This, to me, is the future. Why this small? That's all the space they had. They just didn't have any more space than this, and their business model demanded two control rooms. Now, they're not getting Dolby certified because the room's not big enough, but it does sound and does hit Dolby X-Curve specs, 100%. And they know it, and Dolby's been up there, but they can't sign off on it because the room's not big enough. Dolby has minimum requirements. They mix films here, so they do independent films, and then if they have to, you know, when they have to actually get the Dolby processing on it, they basically take it up to another lab and just run it through once in a room that is certified. You know, basically three speakers behind there. So the trick was, how do we get this little room to get the same sound as a big room? That's the trick, low frequency control. Now in this room, we used an active bass trap. The only one, yeah.
How deep is that room?
14 feet, very small, tiny. Look, there was no room even for 8-inch membrane absorbers. And we used to my knowledge, only one company really makes a marketable active bass trap, which is Bag End. Makes this E-trap. That's their brand. And it works. Actually, the first four went into these two rooms. It was the only solution we could come up with. We just simply could not control the low frequency with any kind of architectural solution, because the rooms are completely isolated from each other. As a matter of fact, they're highly isolated because they have to work at the same time and not disturb each other. So basically, two little speakers in the corner, and they have sensing microphones, and they put the information back out at phase, essentially, is how they do it. But it's pretty tricky, and there's a lot of adjustments. They are stable. They're working. One went out once, but it was just a mechanical thing, and they replaced it. The settings were completely duplicatable because it's digital. So that's kind of cool. That's something I didn't even know about that 5 years ago. Okay, and you know, it's not something I would set out to do. I actually, they of course, my friends at Bag End, and they are our friends, would disagree with me, but I would not start out with that as a solution. I consider that to be a band-aid, or if I'm backed into a corner, excuse the pun, corner. They really do go into corners. Okay, but I don't care. It's just another tool that we have. It's part of the good news part of this talk. Okay? And it's, you know, why did somebody even try to invent that? I don't know, because they saw a market for it, or they thought it was interesting. Well, they thought it was interesting, and now they see a market for it. Personally, I think there's going to be a big market for it, because rooms are getting smaller. Okay? And you're going to get trapped, again, excuse the pun, and how am I going to control my low frequency, and I don't have any room? And the problem came about because these people right here need to hear fairly critically, it turns out in the film. They're not just hanger-oners, they're actually people making decisions, and they were just getting pounded on this wall.
Is this 5.1?
Yeah, not for these guys. These guys are making the content, but, oh, absolutely. And ITU specs, absolutely. Yeah. So, we can do it small, we just need some tricks. And the tricks are out there, the tools are out there. It's very cool. This is a fun one with all the glass and vision and windows outside, overlooking New York. Also very small. Notice these rooms in the back. We have a vocal booth and a machine room in the back of the room. It's the only place we could put them. And over these glass doors, we don't have pictures, I'm sorry. And here, it works. See this kind of, it's shaded a little bit. It's basically a clear piece of plastic with tiny little microperfs in it. So it's absorbent. Yes, we have absorbing glass. It's not glass, it's plastic. But if you could put the microperfs in glass, it's very expensive. You could have absorbing glass. Sound is pushed through the little microperf holes, and it's pretty absorbent. It's absolutely extraordinary. The microperf industry is just arriving in this country. It's been in Europe for a while. It comes from the same industry that actually puts the microperfs in currency. Okay, very, very tiny, small holes. And this piece of plastic, okay, which is represented right there, okay, right, we're looking at it. You know, look at this. This is reversed. I just noticed this. The plan is flipped. See the lettering? Okay. Can't believe that. Anyway, I'm upside down. It was there we had to put it. We had to put it over here on this side. On this guy, because it looked into a window. And then, of course, we had to duplicate it over here. There are tiny little microperfs in here. Without these two hanging plastic microperf shields, the room doesn't work. You'd absolutely have a reflection from the window on the left-hand side, and it would bounce into you, and you'd have a comb filter, okay, which everybody knows what that is. And at the listening position, it would be a disaster. But of course, normally what you'd do is you'd put up panels, which would work, but you don't want to put panels up in front of the glass because then you won't be able to see through. This is very cool. This didn't exist 5 years ago. It didn't exist, period.
Yeah. Is that the RPG part?
RPG makes it. Several people make it. Yeah, RPG more or less tries to make everything. They want to make you and sell you everything. Peter's a dear friend. If they don't make it and they think that someone else makes it, particularly if it's from a foreign country, they'll import it, like the VPN. They call them Modex plates. It's actually a product from Switzerland. But they import it. Yeah, they actually don't make it. They import it. But it is. I can tell you with great assuredness that it really does work. It really is absorbing. I mean, you go up to this piece of plastic, and it should be reflecting, but it's absorbing. This is very cool. Here's a church, albeit it's a kind of a strange church in a speakeasy in New York. That's what it used to look like 50 years ago. But notice the studio. As I said, a lot of churches have studios. That's the church, which we had a lot of fun, and that's the studio. Not that complicated. This is, you know, if I didn't tell you this was in a church, this could be somebody's project studio with a little, very simple equipment, low frequency control above these stretch panels, variable acoustics on the wall because they have to go from very live to very dead sometimes depending on who they're recording. Okay, and this is a studio in a church. That really was a church. This is a private studio in a church because when the guy asked me what kind of building should I look for, I said thick walls and tall ceilings. Thick walls, tall ceilings. He found it. This is in Utica. But what's interesting is he and his partner, they built this studio and they had all the business already. They provide music for some episodic children's TV shows and the other guy writes music for some other kinds of. They more or less didn't need to run it as a commercial studio. They had a need for the studio. They went and built the studio. Again, not that expensive. Look very carefully. Okay, and what you're looking at, the equipment is not that expensive. Most people kind of identify what's there. The trick was to not isolate the live room. That was the costing trick. The trick was to build two vocal booths on either side of the studio, okay, and a control room, of which you're on inside of it. Those are fully isolated rooms, sort of box and box type construction. And then just let the live room be the way it is, We filled up the windows, put some better doors, etc. And yeah, they lose one or two sessions a year in a driving rainstorm or something like that. But now all of a sudden, what could have been a $1 million facility got done for a few a few hundred thousand dollars. Opened the door 6 weeks later, people realized there was a professional studio in Utica, New York, and he actually has rented it ever since. In fact, he had to build another studio in the basement for himself. He kind of got pushed out of his own studio. Very interesting. So, purpose-built studios. I don't know. They used to be called project studios or personal studios. They're not small studios. They're semi-isolated studios. I'm having a little trouble with the acronyms. And the magazines have had trouble with the acronyms. What do we call these studios? I don't care. I'm just trying. I'm more interested in the ride. I'm more interested in the process. I'm comfortable with purpose built, because that doesn't necessarily mean small. It doesn't necessarily be large. When someone calls for a new studio, and this happens two or three times a week, within 5 minutes, I'm trying to get to the most important question, which is, how much isolation do we need? Because that's where the money is. That's where 80% of the money is. It's the isolation. And then the next question is about five questions. Air conditioning, code compliance. Notice no acoustics, not too much acoustics yet. But isolation is where the money is. And most people are not thinking about isolation. You know, I'll usually get an answer like, well, it's not really that noisy that often. You know, I get some kind of ridiculous answer like that. And so then my question back to them is, well, when it is noisy, not that often, is that going to be a bother? So, you know, I flip the ball back on the court, and then pretty soon everybody starts to realize that, well, I guess I am going to have to make a decision about isolation. Do you want to record in a rainstorm? If the answer is no, well, then we don't have to isolate it. Isolation is a little like pregnancy. You're either isolated or you're not isolated. It's kind of hard to be partially isolated. You can have mitigation, isolation mitigation, but this was an interesting solution because here, you fully isolated two small rooms, not very expensive, and let the big room go. Okay? And that was okay. So it was a very clever solution. Small rooms again, we're going to put more of them up. The home theater industry, I think, is driving a lot. I mean, the film industry and the gaming industry are really it's driving a lot of audio. The most advanced audio is coming in films. 5.1, as you know, has kind of flopped for pure audio. It hasn't really gotten traction. There's all kinds of reasons why it hasn't. But it never didn't have traction in the film business. Films have been 5.1 forever. Well, they were 4.1. Actually, they were 4.0, then they were 4.1, and then they were 5.1. And they still are 5.1, and some are 7.1. So they've been, and that's not going anywhere. That's a standard. This is a studio that just mixes DVDs for the home because the curves are different. So there's a whole industry just remixing DVDs just for the home, which is a huge industry. CDs failed, but DVDs didn't fail. DVDs are a huge success because it was a great bargain for the content. Ironically called Mikasa Studios, and it is in a house because it's about the home. Again, low frequency control above the ceilings. And what I like about this one is that it really does look like a house. There's no fooling around. It's like the message is the medium, you know, or the medium is the message. It's in a house. It feels like a house. It's about stuff that ends up in the house. It's very honest. This is literally in someone's house. This is a quintessential project home studio. Okay? Very low ceilings in this little attic that he popped up overlooking the Hudson River. A little bit north of New York, really beautiful location with a great view. And for about $1,200, he's Velcroing his acoustic treatment on the ceiling. This is impossible 10 years ago. This just simply doesn't exist. And now you can just buy it on the web. Comes UPS, ready to go. And if he moves, you can take it with you because it's Velcroed up. Think of it like a microphone. Completely changed the whole room. There's very little in the room other than that and a few well-placed panels that we didn't actually put in until the room was done. The geometry of the room was so goofy, we said, no, let's just wait till it's done. We'll make the measurements. We'll see where the reflections are, and we'll throw up some panels. It was just that simple. He happened to use fabric wrap panels because he didn't want to see foam. Could have been foam. It's all the same. Two even very, very small rooms. Again, the familiar low-frequency control. Very small rooms. 5.1, This is for a radio station. Here, the 5.1 is solved by motorized speakers that pop up, okay, to meet the ITU specs. We'll talk a little bit about that ITU spec, because it did pop up, actually. It popped up as a question a few weeks ago in St. Louis at that Webster NES. The ITU spec is sort of the big cojone of specs. It's the one that everybody's using, but I think it's the one that everybody's using because it's almost the only one that's there. Okay, I don't know if it's right or wrong, but it just is. It's like the X-curve. The X-curve is gospel, but anybody ever, it doesn't really sound that good. It's pretty boring. It's pretty flat, but it is the curve. If you get every theater to agree to the X-curve, and then where you make the content is tuned on the X-curve, why then we have a standard. And so basically everything that comes out for a venue release has got all that high-end pushed, and that's why when you just, in the beginning when they were taking film stems and putting them on DVDs, they didn't sound so good in the home because the home is really different than the venues. Now they have to remix them, and they do remix them, almost every single one. Some out of house, some in-house, okay? But the 5.1 ITU standard seems to have taken some traction. I know a lot of people that have taken the rear speakers and altered that 110 degrees, and they've moved it around. It seems to be what most people are doing. It just gives more envelopment. But there are other parts of the ITU spec. There are reverb times as a function of volume, which I actually agree with. Most small rooms like this, about 0.3 of a second at 1K. I agree with that. I think that's kind of nice, actually a little bit on the bright side. So that's good. Okay. So there are other parts of the spec that I think are good. This 110 degree placement of the rear speakers, I think that's a little bit questionable. Okay. The equidistance requirement of the spec is, of course, optimum, but in reality, extremely impractical and almost impossible to get. Anybody that's tried to lay out a room, this is what you have to do to get them equidistant. You almost can never get the rear speakers to be equidistant. And if you go and end up putting them in a living room, unless you just have a giant living room and you kind of want to float your 5 speakers in it and get a divorce from your wife because this looks ridiculous, it doesn't really happen that way. It always happens a little bit differently. It happens a lot more like a movie theater. Okay, so me, I'm more interested in the Dolby specs or the THX specs. I think the best ones are the THX myself. But another conversation. These are more, these 5.1 listening rooms. Again, small rooms, Dolby certified room, mastering room. Okay, this is a Taupe Acoustic product. These are slatted and or slatted perforated wood panels made in Switzerland, imported now. By RPG, but made from Switzerland. They just saw a product that was overwhelming. And again, wood product, mostly broadband absorptive. Not everybody wants fabric everywhere. Fabric, you know, not everybody likes it. It doesn't hold up so well sometimes. Okay, so these are slatted and perfed wood products that are absorptive at mid and high frequencies. Very interesting. Radio stations are recording studios more and more, particularly the NPR ones. Tremendous opportunity for students. Tremendous opportunity for us as designers. And a lot of content is made, well, I don't have to tell people from Boston, you have one of the best ones in the country in Boston, which we drove by getting here, actually. Again, we'll just go through these really quick. So this is a home studio. That's why I throw this up. This is a private personal studio attached to a home about 30 miles north of New York for an amateur person. It's a person who made his money in another industry, but loves music. His son is a musician, and he built his own studio. I don't know. Is this a big studio? Is this a small studio? Is it a commercial studio? Well, he's not making any money there, although he's actually making money on aspects. Not making any money renting the studio, but he's already had some online music contests from this studio. He's had a webinar from this studio. The model is different. It's just all changing. I don't know what you call it, but this studio has every characteristic of what I guess we used to call commercial studios, and there are a lot of these being built. Equipment's a little different, a lot of digital, a lot of hybrid equipment, mostly midfield monitoring, which I subscribe to completely. The only people that really need the big monitors are mostly the urban music guys. Other than that, I don't think it's really necessary to monitor. I don't even think it's smart. I don't think it accomplishes anything. So mostly the urban guys seem to want that kind of level. Okay. That's his studio. This is a sensational effort. This is Robert Glavellis, CNC Music. It gives me permission to talk about it. So this is a guy that sold 25 million records, owned a number of his own studios, but now his life is different. Now he has three kids. He lives in this house. He says, I want to work in my garage. So literally, we built the studio in the garage. In fact, he named it the Paradise Garage Studio. We even kept it looking like a garage, including the garage doors. You can't even see them. And we just sealed everything up, and that's his studio. Okay, and it's all he needs. Very small live room. If he ever needs more musicians, drives down to New York, rents a studio for a day, no problem. Most of the work is done in the control room. He does want loud music. He does mix very loud. Most of the stuff is dance music, as you know. But you recognize the equipment. Nothing fancy here. It looks like a big desk, but the equipment is actually very simple. Dolby mix room. I like this one. The user of this room loves Adirondack furniture. That's his deal, is the Adirondack. So that's why you got this place looking like that. So a few more slides, and then I'm going to show you some oralization before we leave schools. No surprise, we're seeing more audio production education. On one hand, it looks like there are too many schools. I've heard that argument, and it looks like it's scary that so many students are rolling out of the schools. On the other hand, and we have some educators in the room, John, for instance, on the other hand, and I lecture at schools, a lot of students are leaving these schools and getting jobs. I'm seeing some heads, so no bullshit. I mean, if they weren't, I would tell you that. Most of the qualified schools, you know, Full Sail, Expression, the Art Institutes, Berkeley, Middle Tennessee, Miami, these are good schools. They all have arguably good and interesting programs. If you graduate from those schools and you're a good student, not if you're breathing, if you're just breathing, that doesn't count. But if you did the work and you actually got to the other side of it and you came out of it, you're probably going to get a job. You probably will. There's a lot of opportunity. It's pretty interesting. So here's some school. This is Expression. This is Mount Paran, which is a school we did in Atlanta, the Performing Arts Center, huge performing arts theater, and then a huge studio complex. This is their Performing Arts Center, every bit as professional as you could imagine, with a full-on recording studio complex. These are one of the Art Institute schools. This is from the Mount Paran School. This is Jazz at Lincoln Center, which of course is a performing arts center, but also is an educational institution, and also it's the home of XM Radio. So there's a lot of, is this a school? Is this a recording studio? Is this a 1,200-seat theater in a major city? Is it a foundation? It's everything. Okay, there's a lot of cross-collateralization of usages. Every day I seem to read of another auditorium/studio/broadcasting. Every space seems to be a broadcasting space these days. Because it is. Because it can be. Okay, because it's not that complicated. Because if you can't get a license to broadcast it through the air, who cares? That's uninteresting. I mean, it really is uninteresting. You don't need any licenses anymore to broadcast. You just need a Cat5 cable, is what it's. You don't even need that. So this is the Allen Room at Jazz and Lincoln Center. But in the middle of this huge complex, what appears to be a small piece of it, it's right over here, this tiny little area right here, compared to this big giant complex. Okay, right there is a recording studio. It's actually pretty big. Okay, that's the live room, which is also a rehearsal room, which is also a dance rehearsal room. Okay, and very large control room with some smaller support control rooms. Okay, and by the time they finally opened their door, realizing that they weren't the right people to operate the studio, even though we built it, they made a partnership with XM Radio, and now XM Radio operates it, so it's a broadcasting studio and a recording studio. U2 did their 3D album, that one that's gotten a lot of traction, that's actually amazing. I got to finally see it, a piece of it in 3D at NAB last week. I want to go see it now. It's pretty amazing. Actually, it's extraordinary. And they did all their work in this room. So what can we look forward to? Okay? A few predictions. Okay? All of the facilities that at least that I've seen and that we've flirted with a little bit today, I think they're all going to continue to exist. ratios are just going to change. It's not like any one type of studio has disappeared. Big ones, small ones, purpose-built, et cetera. But we're just going to, they're all going to continue to exist, and we're still going to have more, and we're still going to have even different types expand. I don't think anything's being subtracted. We will have more studios. I absolutely, fundamentally, from the bottom of my heart, believe that, and everything that I know and hear tells me that. Okay? The audio world will continue to be more democratic. I've said that six times, and I also believe that from the bottom of my heart. Better audio will continue to surface. Now, this I can't prove. This I can kind of half pray for, okay, and half wish. But the very fact that we're here tonight, I think, testifies that that is, in fact, what people really want. Okay, despite the possibility of declining listening values, i.e. iPod, et cetera, okay, production values still do remain very high. Okay, I mean, walk around the AES in October and look at the speaker manufacturers, of which it amazes me every year that there's another new speaker manufacturer, as if we needed another speaker. So they range from really good to really, really good to I can't even believe that sounds so good to that's amazing. I mean, that's really what you're walking, you know. So are you really going to make an argument between an Atom and a K&H and a Genelec? Are you really going to convince me that one speaker is better than the other speaker? Different, yes, maybe cheaper, yes, et cetera, et cetera. DSP controlled. There's a lot of things we can talk about, but just how they sound amazing. They sound extraordinary. So now we're in a taste dialogue. We're not in a quality dialogue, in my humble opinion. Okay? I don't know about this one. I think digital and analog will someday be exactly the same. I myself cannot hear the difference anymore between some tests. Now, I'm not an engineer by training, and I don't have the gears that some people have. Same in video. I saw some 4K demonstrations at NAB. I'm sorry. If you told me it was film, it's film. I just don't see the difference. And I believe this difference is getting pretty hairy. But the last one interests me the most. Okay. Room acoustics, okay, will push, not puss, sorry, okay, the limits of critical listening environments. Okay. More and more people are paying more and more attention to room acoustics, particularly as the rooms get smaller, particularly as everything else in the environments basically gets to be the same. There's not that much difference between your gear and your gear. I mean, in some instances, there's no difference between your gear and your gear. So what's the difference? The difference is operator, the environment, and the acoustics. That's really going to be the difference. This is good news for me, I assure you. But we'll continue to have really great gear. The gear is cool. The gear is very cool. And it's getting better and better. It's getting smaller. Digital operating systems are getting easy to use. Desktop technology, all the stuff is really here. And on our end of it, on the acoustics end, very, very cool measuring devices and very, very cool predictive tools. So there have been some real leaps and bounds in the last 5 years. We're going to take a look at some of them, okay? I'm going to skip this, okay? Amazing improvements, though, in acoustics. Skip the last one. Prefabricated acoustic materials. In the last 10 years, this has exploded. Almost didn't exist 10 years ago, with the exception of diffusers and panels. But now, low-frequency membrane absorbers, limp vinyl, all kind. Even in the world of isolation acoustics, which is a little on the boring, dry side, very cool new stuff. I mean, if somebody told you 4 years ago or 2 years ago that someone will arrive on the market with better sheetrock, Sheetrock, that's like wheat. Sheetrock is sheetrock. We need sheetrock. So, thus, quiet rock. I'm not quite sure if it's better, but it certainly exploded in the marketplace, and it's all okay. It is better. What they don't tell you is that it's much more expensive, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? So, we're going to see very, very cool acoustic materials. A lot of companies playing in that field. It's getting easier to play in that field, and there's more use for it. Okay? Low frequency control, big, big challenge as the rooms get smaller. We talked about that already. Okay, isolation and transmission control. as we get more and more studios, there's going to be a need and a desire to have more of them in places that need to be quieter. Hey, can I have a small little 300 square foot studio in that residential tower? Sure you can, but we got to make it quiet so it doesn't bother people. So we're going to need to have better isolation control. Okay, thus there's a market for it. Thus you will have companies like Sirius Materials inventing Quiet Rock, the company that actually created that. Okay, I myself know of at least three projects right now in exploration and patent acquisition, at least three. One by Tony Bon Jovi, who used to own the studio in New York, on isolation materials. He's coming from the helicopter isolation work because he's a helicopter pilot, and he's got a new dampening product that is threatening to arrive on the market, and I've seen some of it, so all I can really talk about. But people are exploring better isolation and better transmission. Computer-aided measurement systems, also spelled wrong, can't spell. Couldn't spell as a kid either. And prediction software. So these are the two cool tools. Okay, better prediction stuff and better measuring stuff. So for instance, something like SMART, which is the one that we use quite a bit. We use Easier, but I still use SMART to gather most of my two-channel information. This is magical. This is $800. This is nothing. Everybody can have this equipment, and it's not that hard to use. This levels the playing field. No bullshit here. Everybody, you know, I can't tell you that room is really responding in a certain way because you can take the same measurement, and either it is or it isn't. So much more democratic, much easier to use. It means we can share the information. It means I don't actually have to fly to Nebraska to get that measurement. Somebody else can get it. Now, what do we do with the measurement? That's different. That's the art. So what it does is it makes the art more interesting. The measurement and the acquisition is now academic. The art becomes interesting. And then the prediction software. And this is the cool stuff. We're going to take a look at it. This is a headline I cut out of a newspaper article. Science makes it unnecessary to erect the auditorium. Okay? We can basically hear the way things sound. Okay? What I like about it is that it's from 1915. That's the cool part of that headline. And this was the New York Times article when they finally publicly released Sabine's work. I couldn't resist popping this up here in this environment because we're in Boston. Okay. Now, his algorithms, you know, he didn't have the tool. Boy, if he had the tools and toys that we have now, it would have been an amazing, amazing moment. Okay. So I want to leave by showing you two oralization demonstrations, which I really like. Oralization, everybody kind of knows what that is, okay? We can go into a room, we can get an impulse response. An impulse response is at least at the moment a pretty good signature of full frequency to full time domain response of the room. So we could loosely call that an acoustic signature of the room. We could then slice the impulse response with FFT math, and we could start to get octave band reverb time or decay rates and frequency response graphs, and we could begin to describe the room. And we can do that, and that's pretty accurate. Okay, and then we can start to talk about it and build standards, etc. Well, suppose we could get the impulse response from a drawing and then push a dry sound through the impulse response. We could, quote, listen to the room, or listen to the room with a send and receive. You'd have to choose a send and choose a receive, down to a few hundred hertz. It's still not quite working 100% at low frequency. But this could become pretty valuable. It could become a valuable sales tool. It could become a valuable design tool because you could sort of start painting and coloring your surfaces. Well, let's just see if that's enough absorption. Let's see if it's too much absorption. Okay? That's oralization. And that is around. It's been around for a while. But it's finally gotten fairly cheap and fairly easy to use. Cheap meaning less than 10 grand for the software. Easy to use meaning desktop. Easy to use meaning it's actually taught by more than one person. Okay, so people are coming out of the universities knowing how to do it. Cat Acoustics seems to be the leader, but there's another one called, Odeon? Or not Odeon. I think it's Odeon out of another company in Europe. Isra, in a sense, has another version of it. We use CAT. We're pretty comfortable with it, mainly probably because we have a lot invested. And now, with AutoCAD, owned by Autodesk, really pushing Revit. Some of you know what that is. That's a different way of drawing, basically building information management. We just We just had our first instruction in it in our office this week, so I'm pretty hot on it. Basically, drawings now being all three-dimensional. Instead of drawing lines that look like 3D, most architectural offices in the next few years will switch over to literally making the building in as models of objects. Really, the objects will be in electronic 3D space, so this will be easy to import into a CAD model. This is all going to become very, very fluid and very, very automatic. This is not going to become mystery anymore. But so let's take an example. This is a church, happens to be in Western Switzerland, okay, which, as you can imagine, had an intelligibility problem because it's all hard surfaces. It's kind of a beautiful church, and the main audio in this church is a man speaking every Sunday. That's what goes on in this church. It's a Protestant church, okay? It's not a very little music, mostly man talking. So it's about talking. They couldn't understand them. And this small village raised a lot of money to try and fix this. Now, arguably, it didn't help that it was all happening through this crappy little speaker. But even with a better speaker, or even with a line array, here, that was just a coverage issue. Even when they got a better speaker, which we finally did, and one that was essentially a vertical line array, so that we could get equal distribution, this still was just a good old-fashioned RT60 problem. Okay, and with all these hard surfaces, that's basically was the measured decay curve. Now, everyone in this room can read this, but you can imagine that the six-person building committee in the small town in Western Switzerland would look at this graph and, what is this? I have no idea what this means. Everyone in this room knows what this means, and probably everybody in this room could take a guess that that room doesn't sound very good. Okay, 7 seconds at 250 hertz, that's like approaching Grand Canyon numbers. That's pretty big, 7 seconds. 0.7 of a second might have been, well, that would be too dry, I think, for a space of that. But you can imagine what this sounded like. So let's hear what it sounded like. Okay. That's what a shutoff, pink noise shutoff was. Except we presented it twice. We measured it. We actually shot pink noise and measured it. And then the second one, which sounded just about the same, was done through a model. We modeled the space, and it sounded the same. We basically took a dry pink noise without any space, and we have those recordings, pushed it through the impulse response that was created from the drawing, from the CAT model, and sounded the same. So then we went in and did this. So that's one of those sentences that has every vowel in it, okay, which you barely could understand what it said. And again, we went in with two presentations. That got us the job. It also, we also cheated a little bit, because when we made the model, if it wasn't the same, what did that mean? It just means we didn't have the right coefficients on the surfaces. What's the model look like? Let's jump to the model looks like that. It kind of looks a little like the building, but it just has enough surfaces so that you can change them. You don't have to actually draw the pews to just get the pews as an object on the floor, okay, et cetera, et cetera. So it sort of looks like the building, and it sort of doesn't. The spit out on the right was some coverage studies we were doing. But now, once every surface is in, you can tell the surface what it is. Is it reflective? Is it absorptive? You can put in angular diffusion coefficients. If you have them, you can put in angular absorption coefficients, which are a little tricky and I think is a new frontier for everybody. I'm looking forward to that, particularly in small rooms, since, as we all know, for 40 years, all these absorption coefficients have been made the same crappy way in a big room, and there's no angularity information on it at all. Okay, if this is a panel, okay, yes, in a big room, statistically, we get the information, but what about when sound goes like this? And I just want that first reflection. How absorptive is it at 30 degrees? I don't think it's the same as the statistical information. In fact, they know it's not the same. We don't have that information. Nobody has that information. So there's a whole new frontier. Nobody's really interested to change that standard, because that's an awful lot of work that everybody now has to buy into that. So I'm sure there's a few AES standards people here that are watching. I'm just sitting in the background waiting for it to happen. So once this was modeled, and now comes the art. This is what you get, this is what we get paid for. So what is the goal? Well, a computer isn't going to spit out the goal. The only thing that spits out the goal is experience, research, maybe going into some other churches, And this is what we thought the goal was. So notice that we're not making it 1 second. Actually, there should be a little Charlton Heston-like action in the church. You know, God, you need a little reverberation. But notice that it got flattened out. Okay, it's not racing off in that low frequency and exploding with all of that low frequency. So we flattened it and lowered it. Okay, and this is and then so this is what we thought the future shutoff would look like. A lot more manageable. But that presentation to the building committee isn't going to mean anything, but this did.
In language, infinitely many words could be written with a small set of letters.
Now that's comfortable. We did this a few times, changing one or two surfaces. Most of the work was done on the ceiling, because that's the only surface they kind of gave us, was the ceiling. Couldn't really change the stone or the floor. Okay, but there were a few other things we could change. There was a back wall we could change. We did it a few times until everybody was comfortable. Okay, everybody signed off, and then basically, these are some of the other models. There's the construction. Basically, we took down all these wood slots and more or less put up some 2-inch thick broadband, actually duct liner, like black insulation, put the wood back up. Okay, and then did some stuff on the back wall, and basically got that curve. I should have put on another slide, I'm sorry. When we were all done, the achieved curve was just about on top, just about the goal curve, almost exactly the same. It's very accurate. Okay, it's not, notice that we stop at 125. Now, stopping at 125 in this church was perfectly reasonable. I'm not very interested in 63 hertz. It's not that meaningful. Recording studios, it's a little different because we are very interested in 63 hertz. But it's very, very accurate, the CAT acoustics, if your data is accurate. And the data is very, very good now. Wasn't 5 years ago, very, very good. So any major project now, we model. We'll show you one more. So some ending slides, okay, some more predictions. And that's, I don't know, that's just me being goofy. Okay, the world's getting flatter, it's getting more democratic, it's getting smaller, that's a Tom Friedman term. And it's all about the music. This is my way of just reminding us all that although there is a science to all of this and a technology, okay, it's about the music. If there's no music, there's really no reason to do this, okay? And I end with three projects. This one I end with, okay, not because this particular slide is interesting, but because just for us and for everybody here, just when you sort of think, you know, you've seen every possibility of everything that you can do, okay, there just seems to be another new challenge right around the corner. Okay, or another new tool or another new toy that arrives, okay, or a whole other opportunity like very thin low frequency control or a new challenge. Like all of a sudden everybody wants 200 square foot control rooms. Oh my God, that's a whole other, we're going to deal with that. Okay, so this was one challenge and it's actually kind of common. How do you get 5.1 ear level monitoring in a room where you still want to look to the front? Okay, now, not everybody needs this requirement, but a lot of studios do because they still want a track, but we still want ear level monitoring. Okay, so our solution was put the speakers, I'll get the little pen back up, but build a room, kind of a typical control room with glass, put five speakers where they want to be. I really only care about the front three, here's two in the back, just to remind you, and then put another layer of glass. Just go to blue, green, put it right there so that we eliminate the SBIR effect, speaker boundary interference. In other words, we now have a complete flush baffle, ear level monitoring, no SBIR effect, no low frequency bounce off the back, everybody's happy, and I'm still looking through, okay? Albeit, it's not one big window, but I have pretty nice sight lines into the room. I've been in this room a few times. Let me get my vision. You know, and you can look through and you do see the studio. And of course, the minute there's a speaker behind this panel, well, actually, it's not there yet, but there will be. And of course, the minute I was all done, I'm saying, well, why couldn't we make this distance thinner? And I could have made the frame thinner and the glass would have been bigger. And I'm trying to just get more glass and less speaker. And I don't know, I remember looking at this a few times in lectures and said, man, we really should just get the speaker in the glass. Wouldn't that be cool? Let's just get rid of all these walls and frames and just put the speaker right in the glass. Then, of course, I'd say, why don't we just make the speaker be the glass? Not quite up to that, but we did take a minor pit stop at why don't we get the speaker in the glass, and we finally got to do it. That's a little personal challenge. Again, it's not New York Times material, but for us, this was a pretty big deal to finally figure out how to do it. It turned out to not be that hard. Ironically, it's a church that owns this studio. Go figure that a church would be the first person to sponsor this. So you need a client that has a little guts, okay? Because I couldn't really show them that we knew how to do it. Actually, this is in Brazil. My partner Renato figured out most of it. And it turned out to not be that hard. The real trick is that the glass plane, which is this guy right here, is not the isolation glass. I'll give you the trick. My wife's probably saying, why are we telling everybody this trick? This is an AES meeting, so that's why. That glass is not the isolation glass. You could take that out, and you could take the speakers. Well, if you took that out, the speakers would sort of topple over. And it would still be isolated. It's a two-wall system. So you build the studio, conceptually, and then the speakers and the glass are just added in front. So once that extra glass doesn't have to be the isolation glass, well, you don't have to be so crazy about how it's mounted. It just has to be strong enough to hold half the speaker weight, okay? And the other trick is to use two subs. When you use two subs, I get an extra extra 6 dB from the second sub, so that means my top speakers can be smaller and it still can be big. So those were two of the tricks. There's a few other tricks in the room. There's a little trick up here that we're not going to tell you about how we're controlling some low frequency and still handling a high frequency bounce. But this is really very cool, and we had a lot of fun. So the real lesson here is, besides kind of demonstrating a cool, you know, something that we think is kind of interesting, and we're going to get to do it again. I'm going to show you our newest project. Yet suggested to put two new ones that are on the board. But that it was interesting that a church is the owner of this studio. I'm not a rock and roll star, not a commercial studio, but a church. It's their private studio, okay, that's busy all the time, okay? And that sometimes you have to get out of the box to go back in and look at something, okay? Whereas that other studio, that other solution was just the kind of speakers and frames and whatnot. Here was like a whole different approach. And then, of course, the two pipes, one pipe holds the power, the other pipe holds the signal. So two new projects that we're doing, and we'll end, okay? We're busy. We have tons of work. And some of the other people in our industry that I talk to are also busy. The biggest studio we're working on right now, big meaning in size, is actually scheduled to be built in China. This is not a gigantic stretch and a gigantic surprise. We have over 1 billion people in China. They have thousands and thousands of Pro Tools rooms. I know this for a fact, but very few studios. When I was in Beijing last year, I saw the three biggest studios. The third biggest city, maybe third or fourth biggest city, is Guangzhou. Also 20 million people or 12 million people. It's bigger than New York. It's huge. They got a lot of 10 million person cities over there. This is in Guangzhou, which is the biggest city north of Hong Kong. We'll now get a brand new studio being built by a music star, a music celebrity over there, as a combination personal and commercial venture, okay, in this very interesting site. It's a little private street, but surrounded by big buildings. It's not, unfortunately, not too much of this left in China. A lot of this seems to be being erased and replaced with that other stuff. But this is the studio we're going to build through these gates, which is this. We're going to tear down a building that's this size and put this studio up. And the concept is very interesting. He wants, and there's a need for, a very big, almost 3,000 square foot live room, orchestra size. They have two major orchestras in the city, and there's no place really to record them other than concert halls. They do have a small studio underneath one of the concert halls, but it's not really big enough. But at the same time, he wants two very large commercial control rooms. One will have a Neve, one will have an SSL. And each of these is a studio. I mean, that right there is a full-on recording studio. Okay, with a fairly big studio and then a smaller ISO booth, sound lock, associated lounge. Okay, same thing over here, but either one of these can track and use the live room, and the way we're getting the isolation is with a corridor between each of them. So you'll actually look through the corridor to the other side. Very, very interesting. These are the sections through the building, fully isolated, and if you look carefully, we're not going to spend too much time, you'll notice that the isolation techniques are all Western. This is all basically kinetic style product, although we're going to use double masonry. The same construction from 40 years ago, electric lady. I just noticed this this morning when I was putting this in the slideshow. Some things just don't change. Basically two thick, dense masonry walls. Over there, it's a no-brainer because that really is the cheapest construction. Their labor is extremely cheap. Masonry is very, very cheap. Concrete is very, very cheap. Drywall and metal stud is more expensive. Over here, it's just the opposite. Huge full-frequency diffusers in the back. So some of this will look familiar, and then we're going to try a few other tricks. Okay. Again, look, these are the side windows, and the front windows are over here, looking through this corridor system to the other side, so that each room can work at 110 dB, I'm not recommending that they work that loud, absolutely simultaneously, while the other one is not. And if one is using the live room, the other one could work and would not hear the live room. And we ran all these simulations in CAT acoustics to check that out. So these are renderings of the live room, the double height space with the clear stories. These are older renderings. They keep changing every week when we change light fixtures and whatnot. But again, all diffusion on the high ceiling. So this is slightly angled and changing panels, but they're all very thin pieces of wood. So they're high, mid-high frequency scattering elements, low frequency absorbing elements. Okay, that's the trick. Okay. And then big screen comes down for projection because it's for orchestra so they can do film work. So I wanted to show you the CAT model on this one. Okay, this is about a week old. We just finished this. Okay, and that's why some of the surfaces actually just got selected based on the CAT model. So this is what it looks like. It sort of looks like that room. Okay, I mean, there's the room. Kind of see that it's similar, okay? But again, just enough surfaces so that we can touch them and change them. And that's exactly what we did. Here, we must have done this about 10 times. This was really for us rather than the client. The client is only seeing one final result, but we just kept changing surfaces till we were happy, okay? And these are the kind of goal curves that we were trying to get. These are our standard upper and lower settings. This is an internal report, even though it looks official and whatnot, it's still really just for our use, and I share this with you. This is the kind of power that these simulation models can give you. You can really figure out exactly where things are going to be. Okay, and then we did a little, this is actually what we're showing to the client. So this was just to see if we were happy with it. So the live setup, basically with orchestra, what will this room sound like with all curtains open, and we have lots of curtains. We have curtains over some of the walls, over the windows, and we even have some high curtains. But with an 80-person orchestra in the room, 80 people is quite absorptive. So that's a big mistake. A lot of people make that mistake. They calculate the RT60, and then 80 people walk in, and now it doesn't sound the same. So we did it with 80 people. Okay, so we were getting... pretty happy with that. We actually ran this by a number of people, and we did it a few times, and everybody's comfortable with it. To be honest, we can't get it too much brighter. There's not too many more surfaces to go. There's no more volume. There's a height limit. The building can't be any more than 8 meters at the peak and 5 at the edges. That's just the way it is. So could have taken more volume. I would have loved more volume on the room for 80 musicians. Then we took the live setup empty. So who would be interested in this? Any rock and roll drummer would be interested in this. Okay? So. That's grand piano. And that's okay, but this is more interesting. So that, there, you know, most rock and roll producers are going to want that. That's what they're looking for their overheads. And then, of course, they get all the close-up mics. That's what you don't get in a small vocal booth. Okay, and that, of course, everybody was smiling when they heard that. And then we tested the room. How dry can we get the room? Okay, so, for instance. As dry as we can get it with overhead mics, obviously, if you close mics. And we were pretty happy with the difference. Based on that, we made a decision to not have any more variable acoustics. That's what this was really about. We could have gotten, you can get it drier. I mean, you could just close the whole thing in gobos and rugs. But what this did was prove to us that we don't need any more panels on the walls, which we kind of didn't want for costing reasons and also for some aesthetic reasons. That was what this was really about. This is very cool. I mean, if we don't have this tool, we're basing these decisions on intuition, which could be interesting and could be useful, and I probably could sell it, but I can't really, in my heart, believe this is true, and I can't share it with the client. There are about four or five people on the client end who are pretty good engineers, and they know what they're listening to. By the way, all this stuff is designed for headphones. You're not getting the full impact of it through, but you put a very good set of headphones on, it's very, very clear. And we did go back and forth a few times, okay? So that's the power of that. Our last project that we'll show you, and this is super live, just coming out of schematics. So just, and it's a good way to end, just when we think that no one's going to build a commercial studio in New York, that's exactly not true. So there's a new studio being built in an amazing site in New York by a very well-known engineer. It will be run as a commercial studio. Granted, this person has a lot of contacts and connections and, you know, has people that are ready to come into it. But, you know, here we are, 2009 for opening in 2010. Good old-fashioned commercial studio, but not so old. Good, old-fashioned in that it will be rented and sold by the day or the week, okay? But let's take a look at it. First of all, you know, it's on the top floor of a very cool building right in the Chelsea area of New York. Panoramic views out of New York. That really will be the view out of the studio, looking uptown in Manhattan. It will be extraordinary. Very tall ceilings, but not particularly big. It's a duplex, okay? And on the lower floor will be two production rooms, because that's all that's really needed. Two relatively small production rooms, not too different in spirit from that room that you saw from Alicia Keys. The person involved here is associated with that project or has been in that room a lot, and that's the model that they're using. Okay, midfield monitoring, okay, although they're Augsburgers, they're just singles. Small, not particularly complicated consoles. One will be a small duality, the other might even just be a control surface. Fair amount of rack equipment, not that much. Okay, but vintage stuff, comfortable, four or five people, okay, very, very tight sounding rooms, and a small ISO room, you know, three or four musicians, right there and right there. But each room gets a lounge, okay, very important. That's on the lower 10th floor, okay, and on the higher 11th floor, or top floor, which is this floor, okay, a very, very nicely proportioned control room. And again, you can, if you read drawings well, you might spot those speakers in the glass routine, so we get to do it again. Okay, and of course, this is a no-brainer. Obviously, we want the control room to look out the windows and to north to New York City. And probably be no studio quite like this in Manhattan. So what's really being chased here? Incredible acoustics. The rooms are not that big. They don't have to be that big, just big enough for 5 to 10 people. But what's really being chased here is environment. You know, the soul of the room and the spirit of the room and basically the artist taking control. Okay, this is all about the artist feeling comfortable. Okay, a few other tricks with the ISO booth here, and you'll be able to look through. You'll be able to, from the lounge, look through the ISO booth to the studio. So that's these kinds of tricks. So, I mean, is this acoustics? Is this architecture? Is this equipment driven? Is this artist driven? I don't know. Not really. It's just what's happening now. But this is live, and so full circle. And just when we think there's no room for another studio, there is room for another studio. Okay? And we'll get to try this experiment for the second time. Okay? This time not for a church. Okay? So, you know, Studio design is live and well, fantastic challenges, and tremendous opportunities for people in audio. Maybe not, you know, mixing the next Aerosmith record. I only bring Aerosmith because they're here. Actually, maybe mixing the Aerosmith record, for all I know. They always have an intern there, I'm sure. Okay, but, you know, maybe the first job is on a cruise ship. Maybe the first job is, you know, number two guy in a radio station. I've met more Full Sail graduates on cruise ships. I've only been on three cruise ships. But every time I go to the audio guy and I know them or they know me, it's hysterical. A lot of opportunities, okay? And a lot of studios being built, small rooms, cheaper equipment, very exciting moments. So I look forward to doing this for as long as possible and sharing this information with students and sharing it with AES members, et cetera. So thank you very much. Well, I know of it. I'm not familiar with it, but I am very familiar with DSP processing systems. I like them. We use them all the time. The one that we fell in love with was the Dolby Lake. I used to not think they were... Well, EQ got a really bad name because people were EQing incorrectly. It's not because the EQs were bad. There were some bad EQs. But they were EQing correctly. Mainly, they were trying to push one-third octave equalizers to make bars be flat. So, of course, the minute you just conceptually try to do that, unless you're a genius, you're going to introduce more phase than frequency control, everything went backwards, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so we all know that now. The minute everybody started recognizing that we should use less of it, not do too much at high frequencies, which you really can't control anyway because it's reflection control, but just use some parametrics at mids and lows sparingly, then everything got better. And so then I, as a group, we fell in love with parametrics. And then, of course, we had the tools to measure them, like a smart equalizer, you know, smart analyzer. So I like, we were using the lake until until they gave up on it. But now I'm told, what's his name, the lab group is going to buy it or they bought it. So we've used VSS and, you know, those guys. And they're all pretty good. The lake was the best one. Meyer's CP10s is excellent. I wish that all five were full frequency, because you kind of don't use the top ones because who cares about the high end? But that was an approach that they had. So, but I like processors that give you parametric control, okay, phase control, and time control. Because if you think about it, unless you're a genius, I mean, or luck is on your side, it's almost impossible to get everything lined up in time. I mean, I think about, it's just almost impossible, particularly with subs. So we use them all the time with a lot of luck.
Do you have any idea?
Not with luck, with a lot of good result.
Do you have any feeling for how many of these rooms we're seeing that people are actually using active EQ, or they're using EQ in addition to whatever?
In these rooms?
Yeah.
I know exactly which ones are using them. Well, we did all these rooms. Yeah. So you want to know, do I know which ones, or you want to know how many?
Are the smaller rooms using EQ more than the larger rooms?
Yes and no. If in the smaller rooms where people are buying self-powered near field and midfields, they tend to not. Okay? Particularly if there's no sub. They money, and they probably don't. The cool thing is that some of these really cool self-powered monitors are coming with onboard EQ. I mean, I just saw one at the show with an onboard parametric. It had one onboard parametric. I think it's K&H. Could be wrong, but I think it's K&H. Genelec has come with the low-frequency tilts for a while. Not exactly the same, but very useful. Okay. There's no argument against a good parametric device in your system. You can't present an argument against it. Don't even go down the road with, oh, I don't want any electronics in my speaker. What do you think was in that box? What do you think's inside there? Okay, cereal? It's all electronics inside this power. It's tons of electronics. So another piece of electronics, if it's a good piece and it's done correctly, can only help. But if you try and chase a comb filter reflection at 800 hertz by putting in a parametric, you know, and then you want to know why 4 inches away, it's, well, you deserve that. You deserve that. Yeah, that means you just didn't understand. It just means you don't get it. Okay, you need to get the reflection. But there's no argument against a good parametric. Okay, and there's some really good ones on the market. And if you get into a 5-1 system or a 5-2, or you know you're taking two subs and you're trying to get them lined up, okay, and we've had a lot of luck with two monitors positioning and flipping them out of phase and then changing the time a little bit, you can really make substantial improvement. How are you going to do that without a box? So I cannot find an argument against it. If you use the right box, of which there are several on the market, you have the right tools, and you just take a few hours. Not a big fan of the self-tuning ones. I think the self-tuning DSP systems are better than nothing, probably, but they don't automatically get you to a 10. Generally speaking, if we arrive in a room with one of those, we just zero it out again and start all over again. But if that's all you can do, it's probably better than nothing. So I think I'm in agreement with that.
If you're rigid membrane absorbers with perforations, do you happen to know, does it matter?
Do you mean the plastic with the microperfs?
Or like the RPG, the Modex?
Okay, Modex is not a perforator. There's no perforations in that. Basically, if you were to buy a Modex and you took off the fabric, which is just decoration, it looks like a tom-tom drum. It's like a rubber. It's not perforated. It's a membrane, okay? And it's essentially changing the phase of what's hitting it. There's no perforations in it. That's different than microperfs. Microperfs, sound being forced through these tiny little holes, friction causes absorption.
Is the diameter size of the hole specific or is it random?
No, very specific. Okay. The membrane absorbers are a function of the membrane density and the distance behind there. And it's a fairly simple formula to do that. The trick is mass producing it and getting them to be all the same and accurate. And RPG, at least says Peter, he says he tests every one. He tests every one in impedance too. I believe him. He wouldn't say it if he didn't do it. And we find them to be pretty accurate. There was a while when they were making the Modexes, like a company was licensing it and making it in England. And they arrived on a site and we weren't happy. I mentioned that. That got corrected. I don't think that's happening anymore. But the ones that come out of Maryland, if they say 63 hertz, he's tested them, and they are absorbing center band 63 hertz. It's pretty accurate. The plate absorbers are really accurate and extremely efficient. They're metal, very thin metal. Okay, but you have to be careful with the plate absorbers. The good news is they're very efficient and they absorb a lot of low-frequency energy. However, you now have a piece of metal in your room, so you better be careful where you put that because you could cause the ridiculous high-frequency bounce. And so in order to compensate that, we used to put a thin little piece of insulation, used to, a few years ago, used to acting like this has been going on for 100 years. The first time we saw this problem, we took the insulation that you'd have in a camper, a little 1 inch of fuzz, and just glued it on. And then we mentioned this at RPG, so now they make the product with insulation. In fact, that's the only way they sell it. Because a big 3-foot by 5-foot piece of metal above you is probably going to be a liability. It's probably a reflection you don't want. Small rooms are tricky. Distances are close. You know what I'm saying? Things are close. Big rooms are easy to deal with. Okay? Reflections are much further apart. By the time they finally get to you, they're 20, 30, 40 feet, 40 milliseconds down the road. They're down and level. They're naturally diffuse. Big rooms are not that complicated. Small rooms are very testy. All right. Well, stay in touch. I'm easy to find, email. I like the dialogue, as you can see. I enjoy this. Thank you again for having me.